yesterday. Anybody lose their power? Most of the people on the east side lost their power, which is where we are. So yesterday afternoon I said, oh, name tags. Well, but my printer won't operate because there's no power. What am I going to do? And I thought, okay, my wife's wonderful caregiver can calligraphy. So she calligraphied, or whatever the word is, all of our name tags. So it worked out very well. Very, very classy. Anyway, I'm Whitney Evans, and I had the opportunity and delightful opportunity in 2019 to found CarePartners as our own Sonoma nonprofit. And that nonprofit had a mission to really support and provide services for families dealing with dementia. We use the term dementia. Alzheimer's is a form of dementia. Dementia is the overall form of many other kinds of memory loss, so that's why we use that terminology. And when my wife was diagnosed back in 2016, we had the opportunity to meet with Dr. Patricia Brooks right here in town, a psychotherapist who's got a specialty in working with people with dementia. And she was so helpful, both to Jeanette and both to myself, in understanding where we are in stage one of dementia and the fact that you go from stage one to stage four and that there's no way to stop that, and knew how to deal with things. I learned about sundowner syndrome. Sundowner syndrome, what the heck is that? Well, what she said to me is, Whitney, at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you shut your computer down, you go sit down with Jeanette and play music. That's when their brains, if you will, have gotten so overloaded that they can't, you know, they really need to be quiet. And frankly, my brain gets overloaded probably sooner than that. But she was terrifically helpful, and I said to her after several sessions, I said, well, how do people learn about how to live with memory loss or live with dementia? And she said, it's really difficult. There are no services here in Sonoma Valley. And I said, okay, why don't we do something about that? And we started Care Partners. We had our very first forum, we call these forums, in October of 2019. And it was, I stood at the door at the end of the forum, and the caregivers were so appreciative that somebody in Sonoma finally, you know, cared and wanted to help, you know, those of us, myself included, you know, be a caregiver. And it really was the motivation for us then to continue to expand. Well, if you think back to the end of 2019, what happened? That guy, COVID. And, well, you can't have a forum like this during COVID. Support groups are a really important thing that we do. You can't have support groups, you know, after COVID. And, you know, we really had to reconfigure what we were trying to do. And it was challenging for sure. And now that that's really behind us, thank goodness. I mean, it's just opened the door to all kinds of opportunities, and you'll hear about a lot of those today, you know, during this time. But I did want to introduce you to some really key people on our team. And two of those are in the back of the room, Suzanne and Jennifer. You know, how do you find people that are interested in working with these people? Well, if there was one thing that was good about Sonoma Developmental Center closing was that people that had the experience in dealing with the most challenged people, those at Developmental Center, you know, they should know, and this should be something that they would really be interested in. And they're both sisters, and they both now work, you know, for, you know, Care Partners, and they're just a wonderful, wonderful asset for us. Well, we then started putting together a board of directors, and Patricia Brooks agreed to be a founding member of our board and is now a board member emeritus, and we're very appreciative of that. We knew we needed people that really understood Sonoma Valley, so Madeline Agramatis, right back here, raised her hand and said, yes, I will join. She's you know, on the board of Sonoma Overnight Support on, you know, and at the health center, and she was a member of city council for ever and a day, and just a wonderful addition to our board, was a caregiver herself. It's been helpful to us really to focus on people that have the caregiving experience as the extra motivation for them to volunteer and get involved. Back in the back of the room, Jim Keck, one of our very first board members. Both Jim's wife also has dementia, and he's been a real stalwart, part of our organization. Got a wonderful background in training, and obviously that is particularly important. So we were delighted to have him come on board, and I wanted to be sure. Actually, the one board member who wasn't able to come, the Reverend Jim Thomas from the Episcopal Church, is on our board, and a pastor like us as caregivers are 24/7 on duty. And he deals with family situations and family dynamics, and it's a very important asset that he brings. He's off on his boat at the moment, so he couldn't make the forum. And then just recently, Madeline said, "Well, you should talk to this guy Tom Deegan. He might be interested." And fortunately, we did talk to Tom Deegan, and again, Tom is a caregiver for his mother-in-law, and that's a very challenging situation because most caregivers are members of the family, be it in-laws or whatever. He brought a lot to the table, got a great background in training and personnel development, and as of 10 days ago, he became our chief executive officer, and we're just delighted to have Tom on board. So we've got a really good board. We're looking for people that have a commitment to what we're trying to do, both as volunteers and as various committees and whatnot. So if you're interested, let us know. I was over in the thrift shop, and the gal there in the said, "Hey, I want to volunteer." Number one signed up volunteer. So it's a great thing that we're trying to do. We're particularly appreciative of Bob and KSVY being here, recording this, because then we have a permanent record that can be on our website, and do look at our website. It's got past forum information. The very first one we did is one in particular. If you're new to dementia, Dr. Patricia Brooks and Dr. Mary Flett, both here in town, nationally known in the field. They talk about dementia and the four stages that you go through, in dementia. So there's some really wonderful resources, there. And what else do I have to say here? Okay, Tom is going to introduce our two speakers, but I tell you, these people are really incredible. And you talk about people in the thick of it, in terms of families with dementia and the services and support they need, they're great. So let me turn it over to Tom.
Thank you, Wendy. Good afternoon. My name's Tom Deegan. I'm, as Wendy said, is the CEO for CarePartners. And I'd like to add my welcome to you and thank you all for attending. I think it's gonna be very informative today. Oh, here we go. How's that? Good. Before we continue our presentation, there's a few house cleaning details I want to take care of. First of all, the bathrooms. Women's bathroom is out in the entryway. Men's bathroom is down the hallway by the kitchen here, if you need that. there's also a folder that you received here. And in the folder, you'll find that on the left side, we have the agenda. And then behind it, you have an evaluation form, which we'd like you to please, at the end, fill that out for us. And then there's the copies of the presentation for both speakers, and with notes, space to take notes next to it. On the right side, we have a little description of what Caregivers does, and then one of our referrals to the Sonoma, village in Sonoma and what they can offer. Along with, we're going to talk about our partners along the wall here when we get to that. And then there's a picture of our website, So please visit the website. As Whitney said, it's very, very, very useful, easy to use. And then there's some pictures of our support group and social activities. So this is what you'll have in your folders. Let's see. Also, if you'd like to have any drinks or snacks, there's some on the table down there as you come in. Please take some with you when you leave so we don't have to carry it all home. And we're also going to have our partners here today. We have our Care Partners table. We have fish over here, and we have Health by the Bay, and Council on Aging didn't show up here. They might still make it. And we have HipCap here for Medicare questions, which Frank will be working that table as he gets done. And hopefully you'll take time afterwards to visit tables, pick up information, and use that. Okay. So moving along here, Care Partners, Whitney has stated, you know, our mission is to increase awareness and support of Sonoma Valley families living with a member with dementia and other symptoms of memory loss. And really what we really have defined ourselves as being is we're here for the caregiver so that we don't end up with two patients. So make sure the caregiver takes care of themselves. So we're here. Our purpose is not to replace anybody, any other organization, not to do anything, but to add to the attention that that caregivers get. Some of the things that we offer from a Care Partner standpoint is we offer day programs that we're going to be doing in this hall coming up in about a month. We're going to be able to change this room into a room that will hold 15 people. And currently at the Vintage House, there's only room for 8, so we're going to double the amount of people here. Plus, we have 2 other locations that we're working on in the town that we should have by the fall, have maybe 3 centers set up with 15 each, so we're going to be able to cover, you know, 45 people, if my math's right. For that right currently in town, we're only doing 1 program with 8. So we feel like we're making a little progress, and thank you for your help. We also have social groups that Jim will talk about a little bit later. Social groups is an opportunity for the person suffering from the dementia to get involved and to have some social activities, like going to Transcendence Theater. We've gone to Pets Lifeline. We've gone to the park, and we've gone to the ballet. So it's a good activity to take people to. And then we also do education, again, our website and forums that we do quarterly here. So that takes care of a lot of the housekeeping and the details that we have. So we'll move along to our speakers. We have 2 speakers today. One, Frank Nelson from HipCap, who will be talking about Medicare and health insurance and be taking questions. And Mary Patista. Right? Piazza. I'm sorry, I knew I was going to mess that up. Piazza, she's an attorney here specializing in senior law, and will be talking to you about, you know, what you need to prepare as a caregiver to take care of that. And before I turn it over to Frank to begin with, I just want to share a brief story that both of these people, I wish I would have known them when I started taking care of my mother-in-law. First of all, they've been playing Publishers Clearinghouse their whole lives. They're 90 years old, so they've been expecting to win Publishers Clearinghouse, and they religiously send the thing back, and they're sure they're going to win. And all it takes is one phone call to somebody says, "You've won. Please send us money." And they didn't understand it. And I think Frank's done a program on fraud about this. And after you send $25,000 away, and then he says, "I don't want to. Don't do that. Don't do that. You can't do that." So we took his money away. He went to his stash money, took it out, went down to the drugstore, and brought another $10,000 worth of gift cards, because now the guy said he was going to get a car if he did it too. So the awareness of the fraud and things, and today you're going to learn more stuff that, you know, I think is just incredible. And the other thing has to do with Mary and the legal aspect. My mother-in-law, we went in to get a power of attorney. We went to the bank, and the bank says, her driver's license expired, and we used to give breaks for, during COVID, but now it's not. So she can't sign her power of attorney. Well, what do we need? You need a birth certificate, okay? My mother-in-law was born on the Big Island in 1932 by a midwife. So now we had to go to Hawaii and find the birth certificate. 8 months later, they come up with a birth certificate. We take it in and say, yay. We go back in the bank, present the birth certificate, and they go, where's this from? And they wouldn't validate the birth certificate because it had been a territorial birth certificate. So, and I'm sure I did everything wrong during this. And but as of today, we think we have it all certain, so now we just need to get it signed. But it was one of those things you thought you could just go take care of, but as Mary will talk about today, preparation is incredible. So let me turn it over now. And I'd like to invite Frank Nelson to come on up. Frank is the Regional Program Manager for the North Bay Medicare Health Insurance Counseling and Advocacy Program, and I think you're going to learn a lot from him. At the end of his presentation, we'll take a few questions. If we have more questions, write them down, and we'll have another question session at the end. Thank you, Frank.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and welcome, everyone. You know, as I'll take that clicker. As a nursing home administrator for 17 years, I have a lot of stories. Having managed nursing homes that had dementia units with individuals and caregivers that were in that whole spectrum. And it's interesting how life progresses to find myself as the program manager for a nonprofit program called HICAP. It's a nationwide program. You're probably familiar with the Medicare and You book, that white book that, let's see, this year it's about 130 some pages that Medicare sends out. If you look on the back of it, you will find HICAP's number. Because this program started in 1986. It spread nationally. And HICAP does two things. One thing is individual one-on-one counseling. And all we do is Medicare. And because we're funded by your tax dollars through the Older Americans Act, it's like Meals on Wheels and some of those other ones, we are truly unbiased as a source you can sit with one-on-one by appointment. And in fact, one of the sites that we have a counselor at is at Vintage House. So in your own community, the counselors are retired volunteers. Now, it's not your usual person that decides learning a 3-inch manual to become a technical expert in Medicare and going through an internship of several months is for everyone. So as we have counselors certified in the 6 counties we serve, over 30 volunteer counselors sitting one-on-one, you can be assured that you get the help. And the A in HICAP is advocacy. So because our specialty is just Medicare, many times when you go to the Social Security office, they will say, you know, you're asking us Medicare questions and we are not Medicare. Go see HICAP. They'll explain things to you and then come back to us and we'll hand you the Medicare form. We'll take your Medicare form. We can look at the Medicare computer, but we are not Medicare. And the second thing that HICAP does is educational seminars like this on Medicare topics. This one is, of course, tailored to some nuances related to Medicare that you will find important. How many of you are caregivers? Okay. And there are a number of you that I'm guessing are getting educated about some of these pieces to consider as you deal with friends and family and loved ones. So today, we are going to talk about some of these pieces related to Medicare as just a general review of the different parts of Medicare and some things to think about. And then I'm going to delve into the more detailed aspects about some very unique pieces related to hospital stays, discharges, ambulances, all these pieces that, of course, well, with Medicare, there's a lot to understand. So as we look at Medicare, we know that a person turns 65 and they become eligible to have their health care as Medicare. People who have been on disability for 24 months, starting month 25, they as well become eligible for Medicare. And there are a few disease processes that should a person have that situation. Lou Gehrig's, end-stage renal, they also qualify for Medicare. Now, of course, some people say, well, I'm still working, and I have coverage through my employee group health plan. Do I have to sign up for Medicare? And the answer is the answer to every Medicare question. And the answer to every Medicare question is it depends. Because if a person is on an employee group health plan and there's a certain number of employees and it is deemed creditable, then yes, they can defer, set aside, enrolling in Medicare until they stop actively working. 1, 3, 5, 7 years later. And there are all sorts of pieces related to that. And once a person becomes eligible for Medicare and decides to enroll in Medicare, they enroll in Part A. Now, for many of us, we see deductions from our paychecks to Medicare. And when you look at a medical procedure, we know that they're very expensive. And there's a bill afterwards. Now, that bill is parsed out to different parts of your Medicare, depending on what it pertains to. If you are admitted into the hospital, into skilled nursing, into hospice, portions of that bill go to Part A, the inpatient part of your Medicare. And for each of these pieces, they have their own premiums. Incidentally, for most people, Part A has no monthly premium if you have enough contributions from those paychecks that we get and contribute. Part A also has a deductible, and this year it's $1,600. There are also daily copays. So when a person is admitted into the hospital, starting day 61 of their cumulative inpatient stay, they have a daily copay of several hundred dollars. Starting day 21 of their inpatient stay at a skilled nursing facility, they have a daily copay. So that's Part A, the inpatient part of your Medicare. Part B is the outpatient part. And that's the majority of the bill when you look at this large charge, and that's your physician charges, the surgeon, the specialist, the medical equipment, the walker, wheelchair, sling. It's your therapy, PT, OT, speech therapy. It's the ambulance, it's the earache that you go to your primary care, is all Part B charges. And you probably recognize the monthly premium for that part, $164.90. is what it is this year. But of course, it may be more for some people and less for other people. All sorts of things to be aware of, but it has a premium. It also has a deductible of $255. I may have that wrong. $200 and some dollars. And it also has its own coinsurance. Had someone ask the other day, Frank, what's the difference between copay and co-insurance? Copay is a dollar amount. You go to the doctor, you pay $20 as a copay. For Part B covers 80%. So co-insurance is a percent. And the percent of the bill that you're responsible for of those outpatient charges is 20%. So suddenly you're thinking, well, wait a minute, Frank. If Part A has a $1,600 deductible, what I have to pay before insurance starts to pay, and Part B has a deductible, and Part B only pays 20%, you mean I'm on the hook for 20% of that $4,000 ambulance ride? Yeah. And 20% of a $170,000 heart attack? Yeah. Unless you purchase another piece. Now, briefly, as you enroll in Medicare, because you're A and B, your inpatient outpatient coverage is your Medicare, then you have a decision to make. Which way do you want your Medicare? Because you notice on the left, one way is called Original Medicare. And if you want your Medicare that way, you add on two other parts for a complete healthcare package. You would add on a product called a Medigap plan. Insurance agents sell it. There are 29 companies selling 10 Medigap plans, like life insurance, car insurance, home insurance, Medigap insurance. And if you're about to turn 65 and you get all sorts of stuff in the mail, that's a large percentage of what you're getting is from agents wanting you to sign up from the Medigap company they represent. Because then they get paid the commission, just like it would be for home insurance, car insurance, etc. Now, of all the Medicare pieces, in my opinion, that's the most complicated. And people get into trouble not understanding some of the protections that there are and the timelines that they could lose the protection. But that's one piece of Original Medicare. And the fourth piece is D. D stands for drugs. Prescriptions. And this year, there are 26 plans. Remember I said that the answer to every Medicare question is, it depends? Here's another tidbit. Every year, everything changes. Plans come, plans go, premiums change, deductibles change. In the case of the drug plans, formularies change. If people don't check every year, then HICAP gets calls about 2 weeks into the new year. I'm standing in my pharmacy and they say 3 of my 10 medications are no longer covered. I don't have $180 to fill this prescription. Well, did you check between October 15 and December 7? Well, no, I mean, I just let my plan roll over because it was a good plan. Every year, everything changes. And that's where HICAP can help with those pieces. So that's one way, is Original Medicare. Go anywhere in the country you want, as long as they accept Medicare. No networks, no pre-approval, no pre-authorization. That's Original Medicare. The other way that you can choose to instead have your Medicare is through what's called an Advantage plan. A managed care plan that contracts with Medicare. Medicare pays them a flat rate for you every month, about $1,000. And then if and when you have a medical situation, Medicare says, don't talk to us. You join them. We paid them. They're in charge of your health care. So, depending on where you live, determines what Advantage plans are available to you. And here in Sonoma County, there are 25. Kaiser is one of them, United Healthcare has one, SCAN, I'm drawing a blank on all the others. But there are a lot of plans to choose from, and every year plans come, plans go, they add different benefits, they change their charge structure, they change their networks. So where 1 year your physician and their group may be contracted, the next year you go in and they say, oh, sorry, we changed our contract and you're going to have to enroll in a different Advantage plan if you want to see us or go find a new doctor. Every year, everything changes. And again, that October 15 through December 7 is an important time frame to attend a HICAP seminar or sit with a HICAP counselor to talk about your situation, to be informed from a truly unbiased source before you step out there. With agents who are compensated, with plans that have seniors running through fields of daisies on these TV commercials. Get educated, and you're doing the right thing. And today, we're going to talk about some very unique pieces that relate to being a caregiver, that relate to, hopefully, the situation that a person might find themselves as living in the community, perhaps living in a skilled nursing facility, in a secure unit. But the important thing to understand when we talk about Medicare, Medicare is insurance. Medicare covers what's called skilled care. Skilled care are those services that can only be administered by a licensed nurse, by a licensed therapist. And at the point that the person no longer needs that level of care that a licensed person must provide, then Medicare says, we're done. And that care becomes custodial. And Medicare does not pay for custodial. So for instance, By the Bay Health provides some hospice care, home health care, but notice what it says on the sign. They provide skilled home health care. Because as a person needs help with bathing and showering and cooking and cleaning, doesn't take a licensed registered nurse or a licensed physical therapist to provide those services. Therefore, Medicare says, we do not provide custodial, and that's where you turn to other sources for those custodial care needs that are not covered under skilled care. So you have a situation. Perhaps Grandpa wasn't as steady. He took a tumble down the stairs. It was Thanksgiving. Everybody was over. There was blood. It was just a difficult situation. Quick, call 911. The ambulance comes, takes him to the hospital. ER looks him over and says, oh my, you've shattered your shoulder. We're going to have to admit you for surgery. Maybe they don't admit the person. So when we look again at that bill, how a hospital gets paid is determined by how the person is categorized. In other words, that doctor's order. If there is not an order for admission, then that bill is sent to Part B, the outpatient part. But once the doctor writes the order for inpatient, then a portion of that bill is sent to the inpatient part. And how the hospital gets paid is different between those two types of inpatient or outpatient. Outpatient is typically line item. Everything has a code. A tongue depressor has a billing code. All these pieces. So they get paid with all these different billing codes. When a person is inpatient, depending on things like DRGs, diagnostic related groups, determine if it was a shoulder surgery, well, then it should be this long and these things would be involved. So here's your payment as a lump sum, which is why hospitals are like, quick, let's get them out, because the longer they're here, the more we're eating into the lump sum that we have been paid. So the challenge becomes this outpatient situation, otherwise called observation status. Now, when we look at skilled nursing, Medicare only covers skilled nursing if you have had a 3-midnight inpatient stay. And the challenge comes when ER admits you. They say, oh my, we're going to have to send you up to second floor, so they get you in the gown. You're on second floor. You may even be overnight. How would you know that you're inpatient or not? Well, your doctor would know. But they keep you under observation, and finally when you get the surgery and then they want to discharge you to skilled nursing is saying, oh, you haven't had a 3-midnight stay inpatient, because one of those nights you were under observation, and it wasn't until the second night that the doctor wrote the order for you to be admitted. So you only have 2 midnights, and Medicare won't cover the stay unless you have the 3 midnights. So some important nuances to understand related to the fact that observation is not sufficient for your Medicare coverage to cover you in skilled nursing. Now remember that ambulance that came because everybody was worried? And you know, head wounds, you get a head wound, it bleeds a lot, sometimes worse than it actually is, but you never know. And sure enough, a few months later, we get this call, or someone made an appointment, because through our website, you can go and make appointments. And They said, we're getting these bills from the ambulance company and we don't understand why. So they set an appointment. The counselor sits down with them and looks through these bills and says, well, here's the situation. Medicare only covers skilled ambulance services. In other words, the ambulance ride, if it requires that level of a paramedic to be riding with you because you could be in a very serious situation. If you could have driven the person to the hospital because, well, you know, it was just a bump on the head or so forth, Medicare looks at that and says, well, obviously didn't need this level of transportation, so we're denying that $4,000 charge. So it's important to understand that if the patient's health would have been jeopardized had she or he or she been transported any other way, then Part B covers it. Or it would be charged to Part B. Now, many times a person goes from the hospital to skilled nursing, or maybe they live in skilled nursing as their place. Again, you see this inpatient, how it gets billed. And if they are going to the hospital from the skilled nursing, then the skilled nursing has been paid a lump sum amount, and they must pay for that ambulance ride. If the person is coming from the hospital to skilled nursing has paid a lump sum, and so they are responsible to pay for that ride. From skilled nursing to home, well, that may depend, but typically, because they have been inpatient in skilled nursing has been paid a lump sum. And therefore, that would be covered under Part A. Now, there are nuances to this, because remember, the answer to every Medicare question of, well, if I'm taking an ambulance, how does it get paid? Well, what's your situation? Were you inpatient or were you custodial in the nursing home? And what was the pay structure? That's the challenge. But be aware that that first part, Medicare pays only if a patient's health would have been jeopardized had he or she been transported any other way. So in an instance where it doesn't take a qualified medical professional to oversee that transport for fear of something happening, then the case could be made, well, how did we know that? Perhaps a hematoma and they could have gone into, you know, arrest or some serious brain, we didn't know. Grandpa fell down the stairs. It's all about what they put on that, what they call the trip report by the ambulance company. And that's, again, where a counselor talks about some of these pieces for you to then get documentation, have another appointment. We can help through the appeal process. But ambulance is one that can be real sticky because those companies are happy to just, oh, Medicare didn't pay for it. Here's your bill. We'd like payment of $4,000. Another component is rehab. We know that as a person comes from the hospital, maybe they had that broken shoulder and it was indeed from falling down the stairs. They were admitted early on, so they had the 3-midnight stay. So they went into skilled nursing for intense physical therapy. Know that Medicare covers skilled nursing, but only to a maximum of 100 days. Now, that doesn't mean that you get a full 100 days. Think of your car insurance. Just because you have a level of coverage doesn't mean that if you get in a fender bender, they automatically write you a check for the full amount. Same thing with Medicare. Medicare will only cover skilled services as long as skilled services are necessary. As long as it still takes a physical therapist to be able to do that treatment. Because I could be your friend, and if your shoulder is out, I'll say, I'll help you here, one and a two and a... He says, no, you stay away from me. You don't know about these things. I just came out of surgery. So it does take a therapist to work, but at the point that a non-therapist is able to do treatments and so forth, and Medicare says, we're done. It may be day 12. It may be day 31. It may be day 45. But at the point that Medicare says they're done, then you have a daily copay starting day 21. And after that, then you would have custodial care. Or perhaps you'd go home and the therapist would come in and do a treatment for 20 minutes and then leave. And the nurse would come into the home and check and then leave. Medicare would pay for those pieces. Well, what about getting up in the morning? Well, that's custodial. You'll have to work that out. Long-term care insurance, home health companies, bank account that you're paying privately for someone to come and help with those custodial care issues. Now, when we talk about Advantage plans, the other way you can choose to instead have your Medicare, remember I said that Medicare pays them for you, and when you have a medical situation, they are responsible for your care. And how they are structured is with networks. This hospital is part of our network. This group of physicians is part of our network. We have a home health arm that's part of the network. Yeah, but the world-renowned specialist is over in, you know, Stanford Hospital. Well, we're not contracted with Stanford Hospital, so you can see our guy in Sonoma. And when it comes to skilled nursing, again, they have a network. And rather than paying on day 21, they have daily copays. Well, it depends. Each company is structured a bit differently. Some don't have for the first 5 days. Some don't for the first 20. Some don't at all. Some have a daily upfront. They are responsible. And also, they have to continually approve. So as therapy says, well, the person is progressing towards the goals, then the Advantage plan says, well, then we will approve another 7 days worth of treatment at this level, at this reimbursement. Now, what has happened is a lack of improvement. Now, I was an administrator back in 2000, what was it now, seven? Eight? Those are very different days in the nursing home industry. What happened is this standard. So imagine someone who has cognitive issues, and the therapist comes in and says, you know, you had that shoulder surgery, they're not interpreting pain as you and I might, and we want to give you pain because we're therapists and this is what the treatment plan says, and they're like, no, I don't want it. What does resident right say? It says the resident has the right to decline. But the therapist is stuck in this, we've got to provide treatment because the insurance plan said it's approved, but we can't show any progression because the patient continually says, you get out of here. I don't want it. Y'all, you guys are just trying. And you can't get anywhere. Now, there was a case, Jimmo versus Sebelius, that challenged that requirement to improve. And at the end of that case, Medicare clarified that that was never the intention. Because you have someone who's not cooperating. And what happens when you're just lying in bed or sitting in a chair, to your muscles, to your ligaments, to all these things, and suddenly it's this slippery slope where you have skin breakdown, you have contractures, you have loss of muscle tone, all of these components that come into play because they won't participate in rehab. And that's where this case clarified skilled nursing and therapy in the skilled nursing setting is still required to provide therapy to maintain function. When skilled services are required in order to provide care that is reasonable and necessary, to prevent or slow further deterioration, coverage cannot be denied based on the absence of potential for improvement or restoration. That's a very important part, especially as we talk with someone who might have cognitive issues, who doesn't interpret pain in the ways that are typical, who may not understand in this foreign environment and this strange person coming in and trying to do some things. Well, thank you for that. And the important part is getting educated. I mean, it's Medicare. The book is 130-some pages. But unfortunately, as our bodies age, so does the importance of that part of our life. In understanding, in this complex world we live in, of scams, of 132-page Medicare book, there are resources. And that's where we're glad to reinforce some of the things that you may not know and provide the ability to sit down one-on-one with someone who's truly unbiased and get the advocacy as you run into situations related to Medicare. And of course, I touch briefly on the home health. Many people think, well, Medicare covers home health. Well, yes, they do. But it depends. There are limitations on time. There are limitations on treatment. There are limitations on, well, who provides the treatment according to what Medicare will cover and all of those pieces. So again, understanding that difference between skilled and custodial, what Medicare will pay for and what is not covered, hopefully turns you in directions to understand, well, if there are custodial care needs, how is that going to be covered? And there are a variety of options to understand. Here's another one. Remember we said that if a person is at home and gets treatment and so forth, do they have to be homebound in order to qualify for Medicare to come and provide treatment at home? And the answer is, perhaps. It depends. Medicare considers you homebound if you need the help of another person or medical equipment such as crutches or walker or wheelchair to leave your home, or the doctor believes that your health or illness could get worse if you leave home. Look at that number two. And if it is difficult for you to leave your home and you typically cannot do it. Well, mom goes to church on Sunday. Well, mom goes to a therapy treatment once a week. It is typically difficult for mom to leave her home. Therefore, even though once a week or twice a week she goes out, Medicare may still cover that home health because the person under the definition is still considered homebound, even though they do get out sometimes. But the important part relates to if you need assistance of walkers or crutches and it could make your treatment worse if you had to leave. Maybe you have treatments and therapy 4 times a week. Yeah, mom can handle once a week and we get her in, then she sits and then the service is over and we take her home. That's very different than trying to get her to the physical therapy clinic down the street 4 times a week. So this homebound concept is an important piece to understand. You know, as you sit back and you think about all of these choices, well, do I do original and switch from 1 year to the next, from original to advantage? Do I switch from one advantage to a different during October through December? Do I switch from advantage back to original? which advantage plan shall I choose of the 25? Which drug plan shall I choose of the 26? I offer you two lenses to step back and look at everything through. One, how's your health? Because for her and I, she may have one of the drug plans and it's the best plan for her and the absolute worst plan for me. I'm on different medications. He may say, well, I'm on this Advantage plan. It's just terrific. It provides pet care and air purifiers and gym memberships and all of these things. It may be the worst one for me because I need to see specific doctors and not have a middleman saying yes or no. So how is your health? And because health changes every year, make sure you check every year whether whatever you have is still best for your health. But wait, there's a second part. Not only your health, but what makes the most sense financially. Because this year, your existing plan may be good for your health, and it may be the most cost-effective for your situation. Every year, what? Everything changes. So as suddenly your network of doctors in an Advantage plan changes, suddenly you find out that several of your prescriptions are no longer covered. Suddenly you find out that, well, I didn't bother checking the drug plans, and I didn't realize I was spending $1,100 a year just lighting it on fire because I was enrolled in a $130 a month plan, and it's the $13 a month plan that would have covered all my prescriptions. Or I wasn't aware that if I just walked across the street to this different pharmacy under my plan, I'd be saving $50 a month because not only which plan you choose, but which pharmacy you go pick it up at has a huge bearing on how much you'll end up paying when you add it up at the end of the year. So every year, take some time, and again, the plug for HICAP, I'm here and glad to offer that service as an unbiased program to help you each year. So how's my health? And what's changing next year? So whatever decision you make by December 7, you're assured that you will have what you need come January 1st. And not sadly finding out, I was paying $1,100 a year for the past 7 years because I didn't check anything. Well, we are here and glad to help. Again, our website is a resource. If a person during October through December wants to check their drug plans, you can click a button, type in your medications, and hit submit, and we will send you the three least expensive plans specific to your medications. For the Medigap, that supplemental piece, if you have your Medicare that way, we can also do a search, hit another button, enter in some details, hit submit, and we send you the three least expensive companies. We have the seminars, we have all sorts of things. You're welcome to go on our website, make an appointment. There's a big orange button if you want to. I mean, even now, you go get your hair done, maybe you go online and say, well, how about Tuesday? Oh, it's Tuesday, Thursday, Friday's open, Friday, yeah. 1, 2, or 3, yeah, 1 o'clock works fine. And you've got an appointment. We are glad to help. Now with that, we are going to take questions at the end because as Mary and I tag team, I know you'll have questions for her, you'll have questions for me, and I want to make sure she has time. But before that, let's take a break, get a chance to stretch, walk around, and I hope this has been helpful, and I look forward to talking with you more. Thank you.
Minute break, come back at 2:10 and we'll get started with Mary. And this card here, we have them available for you. And what it says here is it's a courtesy card. It says, my companion has dementia. Your understanding is appreciated. So when you go out in public or if you're somewhere, carry the cards with you. And then if somebody has a question, just hand them, and it seems to work very well. So we're going to get started now. And last thing before I introduce Mary is the tables will all be here afterwards for more questions. The speakers will be here afterwards for more questions and visits. We have Frank's presentation. He has a hard copy of it as well as one in your folder. And Mary, hard copy of her presentation is on your chair. So right now I'd like to introduce you to Mary, and she can take over. Thank you.
Okay, well, good afternoon, superheroes. Oh, wait, I mean caregivers. But for today, I'm going to call you care heroes, because that is what you are. Every day you wake up, you don your superhero cape, and you get ready to conquer the unexpected. Now, I want to ask you, how is that for a start? Because there was a lot of debate over how I should start this talk today. Oh, is that not?
You're doing a good job.
Okay.
I'm going to try to loosen this up. They can't hear you in the back.
Sorry, guys, I'm a novice, but here you go. Thank you for your patience. So the debate, does anybody here know Bill Shea in town? Yeah? Okay. So Bill Shea is an attorney that I work with, and he said, Mary, you should start this talk by singing. And he broke out into song in the hallway of my office, to which I said, Bill, why don't you come and sing? That would be lovely. And but I've decided not to expose you all to that torture. Frank, do you want to play? And then, you know, one of my law partners suggested, he said, Mary, just get to the point. Tell them that they're there to talk about the unexpected and death. To which I said, well, that's why us lawyers are definitely invited to all the parties. Invite me, we'll talk about death. So today, my goal, seriously speaking, is to have you benefit from this time and leave with some tools. They may be tools that you will actually need, at least two of them probably are, and there are others that I just want to plant the seeds of understanding. So if you or your friends need them, you'll think, oh, I remember hearing about that. Now, the tools that we're going to talk today are very much like an artist's process in rendering a masterpiece. This here is a masterpiece by 85-year-old local artist Fred Parker. He is a pointillistic master. He also may be moving, which is a tragedy for the community, and he's having a sale on his art right now. But what he uses, these are all tiny dots, and I apologize, technology is not what it should be. You can't really experience the beauty of this. And he uses for tools paints, paintbrushes, and canvases. But for caregivers, in your toolboxes that I'm going to talk to you about today, I'm going to talk about legal documents, your team, finances, liability limits, advocacy lingo, and additional resources. And if I'm lucky, hopefully, this presentation will be better for you than watching paint dry. All right. As an estate elder law attorney, the first tool I want to talk about are legal documents. But first, I want to read the room, and I want to know who of you are going to need these. So if you will honor me by raising your hand if you have a bank account. Anybody have a bank account? Okay, put your hands down. Raise your hand if you have a body. Everybody have a body, right? Okay. So two of these documents, all of you need with those things. Before we get there, however, I want to give you some context. The first one is an overview of the time frames in which these documents take place. What this is it's a continuum that talks about life, here it is, ready, death, and then your legacy. During your life, the documents that are at issue are your powers of attorney and healthcare directives. Those I'm going to go into great detail, and at the objection of some of my partners, I had given you samples in this packet. but don't use them without consulting your own private attorney. All right. Then after one passes, the documents that come into play are wills, trusts, and a myriad of other estate planning tax documents that are beyond the scope of this talk because they're really not applicable current tools that can help caregivers, care heroes. Now, these documents are put into place in the process of an estate plan. That plan I like to talk about in phases. Now, again, this is like a 35-minute speed dating type presentation, so I am not going to go into all of these phases. I'm going to focus on one of them. But in order for you to understand that, I want you to have a little bit to know about the process here. The first part is actually considering the goals of the family, the business entities, the legacy interests. The second part of a plan is creating, crafting, and executing the documents that are necessary. The third stage is when those documents are actually being used, and that is really when you are in the care hero type of situation. And then there is after death, here it is again, the after, and that is when the documents run the show through estate administration, probate proceedings, and whatever else needs to happen with succession planning. So, I have a four-year-old little girl. I call her Dragon. She's fiercely independent and amazing and blonde. And she said, Mommy, I want to hear the marble talk. So here's the marble talk. In order for you to understand the importance of documents and the two I'm going to get into in a minute here, one has to have the capacity to execute those documents. Now the law as it is very gray in this area. It describes capacity as any natural person having the capacity to contract. They may execute a power of attorney. Okay, what does that mean? All persons are capable of contracting except minors, persons of unsound mind, and persons deprived of their civil rights. So the legislature went a little further and described it even clearer to say that capacity is whether the individual is capable of having an understanding. Well, thanks a lot. So in order to find and summarize kind of these concepts for you, aside from the books and the extensive education I have on this topic, there's a quote from a beautiful case in the 1940s that describes capacity in that evaluation as the process of basically explaining that old age alone does not render a person incompetent of executing a deed, not sickness, extreme distress, debility of body, they do not affect capacity of a grantor to make conveyance if sufficient intelligence remains. So this is where doctors and I have a lot of fun because they have their standards of capacity and I have my standards of capacity. And we argue about this. And in fact, one of my girlfriends who's a very high up physician at Kaiser, she said, Mary, we should do a talk. What? The capacity where people could benefit from hearing us go back and forth on this. So here's the marbles, ready? Doctors look at the entire bag of marbles. If one of these marbles is off, you don't have medical capacity. In my field, it's the reverse. I am trained and I'm looking for the one marble of capacity. So this means someone could have late stage dementia. They could have very significant impairment physically and mentally. But if they have moments of lucidity where they're saying they want their daughter to make their healthcare decisions for them, or they want to leave their family ranch to their nephew instead of someone else in the family because they want to avoid property reassessment taxation under Prop 19, guess what? I can build that case for capacity, potentially. Now, do not go out and have loved ones with impairment issues executing documents based on the statement. I am making this to educate you about the difference between health capacity is determined by physicians and legal capacity is determined by lawyers. So here we go. Document number one. So for all of you who raised your hands about having bank accounts, you need powers of attorney. And it's shocking, the statistics about this. 80% of elders lack proper healthcare directives and powers of attorney. That's something that I learned from local fiduciary, Carol Young. She is incredible, and I'll talk more about fiduciaries later. So what is a power of attorney? People get confused. So a power of attorney for finance is a document in which someone names someone else to manage their financial affairs in the event that they are unable to. They're governed by Division 4.5 of the probate code. There are different types. In your packet that was on your chairs, and you can thank my staffers for doing this, there is a sample uniform statutory power of attorney. This is delineated by the California legislature as sufficient language to presumptively work as a power of attorney. There are also custom powers of attorney. And that, depending on the situation, sometimes depending on the capacity thresholds, that determines which one is going to be used. There are requirements for these to be effective. They need to be signed, dated before a notary. And then there are different types as far as the threshold in which they become effective. Some are effective immediately. Now, this makes a lot of people nervous, kind of like me here speaking before you all today. But, you know, people don't want to sign something necessarily that is effective immediately, that would give someone else power over, you know, and here's the list with respect to the statutory version. Real estate, stock transactions, property, you know, thresholds, bank accounts. People get really concerned about that. But there's a reason to have something immediately active. It's so that you don't have delay in waiting for a doctor to determine capacity, which guess what? They don't want to do anyway in general. You have a document that is signed, it's ready to go in your time of need. So if you don't have them, if your friends don't have them, if your loved ones don't have them, make sure you get appropriate powers of attorney. There are some tips on this. Instead of doing something online, it's important to consider the overall dynamics and what things would need to be done. So for example, if there are extensive irrevocable trusts, if there are folks with changing medical issues over time, it's important to be able to have flexibility and a power of attorney that can evolve and let the agent act in those ways. That would not be a statutory power of attorney. And also, another thing to look for is if you have done these in the past, take it out, read it. It should not be lumped as in the same document as your healthcare directive. All right, document two. For all of you who raised your hands about having bodies, the second document I want to discuss are healthcare directives and give you an overview of different options for healthcare directives. These are also called power of attorneys for healthcare, and they allow someone other than the signer to make decisions for the principal on health issues. I could go into the history and geek out about how these were developed over time, but there's really not time for that today. Like a financial power of attorney, there are statutory powers of attorney and also custom drafted forms. The handout includes two. It includes the statutory one at 4-7, and then a more extensive version that was provided to me by one of my clients who is very involved in hospice. And when you need something to read, check that out and see what you prefer. It's just good to know. These also can be immediate or take effect upon incapacity. It will cover decisions during life, after life, and even will jump into conservatorship issues. There are requirements, of course, signed, dated by the signer before a notary. And a word of warning, don't be taking this in somewhere if your loved one is in a nursing facility. Frank probably has stories about that. because there are special requirements for signing these if someone is in a situation where they are being under the control of someone else in a healthcare context. Okay, so to get you familiar with what this document looks like, the first page is going to be instructions. The second page is going to have decisions with respect to authority. The third page will talk about the big question. Here we go again, end of life, prolong or not prolong, pain relief and other wishes. Now, with respect to pain relief and other wishes, depending on the scenario, I have a client who's not from Sonoma. My clients are global, and she was a midwife, and she had very specific desires with respect to her health care. So she had a four-page memo about what she wanted to have happen in different circumstances. So my advice to her was, you know, this document is like an overarching order. You want it to be very direct and clear, and to provide those directives to the person that you're empowering to make those decisions for you. So in our society, we don't want to talk about these things, but it is so important, and that is one way to do it. You can write down all the things you want. When it comes to pain relief, I have former physician clients who are very specific about their pain medication choices. In addition, addicts. You know, addicts want, in general, sometimes to have relief from pain, but only to a certain amount. And that is something that's critical to include in these documents here. And then there's the ability to customize with other wishes. And that's where, for example, I have some Orthodox Jewish clients that will include addendums about religious preferences. Now, as an interlude after all of that very deep talk, here's another picture by Fred Parker. This was Maxwell Farms before Lucky's went up there. And he has many versions of this. All right, tool number two, your team. When you're in the world of being a care hero, it's very important to marshal your resources. You want to collect and curate them and know who else you may need to add or not. So on the slide or in the handouts, you can write out when you want, you know, who are your trusted advisors? Accountants, financial people, doctors, lawyers, etc. And then know that there may come a time where you'll need a care manager. What a care manager does is they can craft and manage care plans, help match the individual with different residence type, you know, nursing home type situations, and be there depending on what the needs are at the time. In addition, private fiduciaries are a huge resource for certain family dynamics. A fiduciary is a licensed insured professional who can jump in and manage many things. They can jump in and run businesses. They can jump in and manage bill pay. They can jump in and even manage health decisions for certain folks. My office will get involved when help, connecting clients to these things. There was one client who had no one, and with a very sizable taxable estate, so that's $12 million and up. And so we got a fiduciary in there, the fiduciary lined up the team, we got care resources in there, and you know, he was, his goals were being taken care of. And then of course, caregivers. So when you as a care superhero need to bring in relief, as soon as you're paying a caregiver though, there are some other things that you need to think about in the world of legal liability limits and protections. All right. A lot of these things are expensive. So you have a huge resource by having Frank here today. And the third tool is, for all those of you with bank accounts, it's doing a financial review. So I am not a financial expert at all. But the folks down on Broadway at Sonoma Wealth Advisors, or your own financial folks, are. And Sonoma Wealth Advisors provided a list for folks to consider that I could share with you at this presentation today. You have a copy in the materials. There's also a white paper that gives an example about caregiving considerations that I co-authored with them. But in short, you want to look at a budget, review your insurance policies, explore financial assistance programs, consider tax benefits, protect your finances, those are asset protection trusts, irrevocable trusts, etc. plan for the future, and bring on your professional advisors. There's a little bit of a theme. Speaking of professional advisors, I would not be doing you a service unless I talked about the fourth tool, which is limiting your liability. So, newsflash, being a care superhero means that when you hire someone to come into the home and help your loved one, you are now an employer, even if that is some type of swap type situation where you're having your masseuse live in with you for free rent and, you know, taking care of you. I've seen that situation, did not end well. In any event, if you're becoming an employer, there's all sorts of exposure. So what happens if that person gets hurt? I mean, caregiving is a physical job. I have managed, you know, I know how to use a Hoyer lift and change diapers and all that. And you know what? I lift weights and work out, but not everybody does, right? So it could be like very, you know, it's so ripe for someone to get physically hurt in a serious way. And if you own your home, depending on, you know, that or your assets, if the caregiver does not have insurance, well, guess who's on the hook? You are. What if you want to fire them? What if they start claiming that you harassed them? Well, then you've got all sorts of other potential exposure points too. So the solutions for you are to consider who you are hiring and how you are hiring them. Note that there are lots of great agencies out there. An agency hires, the agency will have insurance for the caregivers. In addition, they'll act as a buffer between you and the caregiver when all of a sudden you don't like your divine Fijian who's in the home, you know, serving your loved one. If, however, you decide to go rogue because you can handle everything yourself because you're a superhero, and you are, I respect that, what you're going to want to do is to call your homeowner's insurance broker. And you're going to want to find out if your insurance includes caregiver coverage. If it doesn't, you ask the very general question, how do I get this coverage? Caregiver coverage. Get it. In addition, if you're bringing someone in privately, because again, you're a superhero, you're going to want to consider having agreements around that relationship. Employment contracts, ensuring that they're at-will employees. If they're going to live in the home, you want to have eviction rights. So rental agreements. The employment lawyers at my firm were preparing a sample contract to provide to you today, and we'll have to do that at another time. It's just too much information. All right, the fifth tool I want to talk about, and Frank over here kind of jumped on that already too, is advocacy lingo. So this is when your loved one finds themselves staying outside of the home, hospitals, skilled nursing. There are all sorts of rights that come into play, and you might not know about them, and you may be subject to a barrage of manipulation by nurses trying to guilt trip you into taking your loved one home. It happens on many levels, and maybe you would want to know what your rights are. There is an incredible resource in California. There are many. Of course, you've got Frank Nelson here, but there's also the California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform. Their website is unbelievably dense, and don't let their name fool you, because they don't just give information about nursing homes. They give information sheets about hospital stays and how to fight discharges, along with phone numbers to folks who will do that for you if, for whatever reason, because you're exhausted as a caregiver, you can't do it yourself, right? Or you choose to outsource and delegate, which is a very appropriate strategy. So, before you get to that part, though, there are some key terms that can be thrown around in the industry. And there are a few that I'll say here, but I bet Frank has some ideas on this. Progress is one, whether a discharge is going to be safe or unsafe, and what the conditions are that the individual is being sent to. So if there's adequate or inadequate caregiving at home. Frank, do you have any thoughts on that? Are there further buzzwords that people should write down as they're here today?
Well, I touched briefly on the rehab and the expectation of progress. So that's an important one, that progress really isn't the measure. And nursing homes, many of them, even though there was that lawsuit, they're still not on board, and they will cite progress or lack thereof as a reason to discharge the person. When we look at a safe discharge, that's a difficult one. And, you know, as whose responsibility is safe discharge? It's the facilities. So they need to ensure that person is being discharged safely. They can't just send them out on the street or send them to a friend's house that happened to come visit a few times unless they can assure that it's truly a safe discharge related to conditions. I mean, we've been in some places that it might be a safe discharge, but the conditions are less than desirable for that individual. And adequate care. Okay, it's a safe discharge, or it appears to be a safe discharge, but who's providing that care? And once again, that's an important component, and thank you, Mary, for bringing those up, because so often, as a nursing home administrator, ran into those situations many times, and being on the facility side, being really frustrated at not being able to discharge a person because some of these conditions were not met, and the onus and the responsibility lies with the skilled nursing facility or the hospital to simply discharge a person back home where maybe hoarding is a dynamic and not having this infrastructure to make sure they have meals and so forth. It's the hospital's responsibility, and that's where, as an advocate, again, as a friend, as a relative that is not contractually engaged, you know, the onus is on these places, according to the guidelines, to make sure these conditions are met. Progress, or safe discharge, the conditions the person is going into, and it is their responsibility, not yours, unless you're contractually obligated in that role to make those decisions.
Thank you, Frank. So I think the message here is that there's a lot of thoughtful power to be used in advocating for someone in those situations, and to talk to the social workers and to take a minute and educate yourself about your rights and their rights and what you can do, and buy time. And you buy time through the discharge process and appealing that discharge, and you can appeal it more than once. So anyway, like I said, you may never need that information, but now you know. The last tool I want to talk about today is having additional resources at your ready. And these are in the form of organizations that you may want to call if you need it, because you don't really know what the situation is going to present in the future. Care managers are huge resources. Private fiduciaries, and community organizations. And how awesome is it that Sonoma has now the CarePartners Initiative, thank you Whitney Evans, to offer such a beautiful place to gather and support folks. And you also have other organizations here that you can talk to and put on your list. But right here is a list, it's in your handouts. This was put together by a care manager company that I work with often for clients. They're called Legacy Concierge Services. They're out of Petaluma, but their clients are all over. In fact, they've helped me with family members on the other side of the country. And so they put together this list, the Aging and Disability Resource Guide, Alzheimer's Association, Area Agency on Aging. There's CANER that I talked about, Council on Aging, Fall Prevention, their own number if you need them, PACE program, Petaluma People Services, the Professional Fiduciary Association of California. That's how you could go about searching and identifying and finding a licensed fiduciary if you didn't want to call and ask me. I do complimentary consultations as a resource and public service for our community. So I won't charge you for that call. Senior Advocacy Services, which is awesome, Sonoma County Paratransit, and the villages of Sonoma Valley, which Whitney will talk about a lot sometimes. It's a great group. So don't forget My Little Firm as a resource. The building's been there since the dawn of time, just kidding, the 1900s. There's always been a lawyer there. They're actually predecessors to my firm. And, you know, my team is there to help. And like, so like Fred Parker's incredible art, you know, doing all the little dots, it can be super hard, right? Caregiving's the same way, but at the end, it surely is worth it, right? You want to be there for everyone. So thank you guys for your time today.
Okay, thank you. We have a group of partners here today that we're going to give each a few minutes to tell a little bit about what they're doing. We also have an evaluation form. Make sure you fill that out and get that ready, and then we'll have questions as soon as we're done with them. So we're going to start out with, let's see who's up first. There you go. Health by the Bay. Sure, if everybody can hear you.
My name's Rob Matheson. I'm from By the Bay Health, and again, thank you for the invite to have us be here today. So many of you may know us formerly as Hospice By the Bay, which is what we were forever, but with our expanded lines of business of not just hospice care, but home health care and palliative care, a couple of years ago we decided, I think for a couple different reasons, but to update our name because it's more comprehensive about what we do. Yeah, go ahead. You have a question? Yeah. Oh, sorry. Well, I'll try and block the light. But anyway, so we were founded in 1975. We're the oldest hospice provider in the state of California. We're the second oldest one in the United States. Our founders wrote a lot of the original Medicare Part A language around the hospice benefit. So important for you to understand if you are on hospice care or want to or know someone who potentially would benefit from the services, everything that we do within that piece of our business is all covered by Medicare. So all the skilled nursing visits, all the durable medical equipment, so if you needed a hospital bed, a wheelchair, a walker, all those things are covered. All the visits from the nurses, the home health aides, the spiritual support folks, social workers. So we're all designed to really make sure that everybody benefits. And it's not just the patient, but it's the family too. So when you think about hospice care, you think, who really benefits from this? It's everyone that's involved, the caregivers, the family, and any individual that potentially would benefit from the services. So, and I guess my last thing I'll say, the average length of stay for someone on hospice care is about 21 days. And in reality, you could be on hospice care for 6 months. And we have people that graduate from hospice. They get better because of the excellent level of service that they receive. We've kicked an 102-year-old woman off of hospice care last fall because she continued to get better. So if you see someone really declining, don't be so afraid to get a referral from your physician. Have a conversation with me or with our clinical team because it's not a bad thing to be on hospice care. And a lot of people think like you're just gonna drug my loved one up and kill him. And that's not what it's about. So anyway, that's my elevator pitch for us. Yeah.
Hi, are we on? We can start talking from here. I will try to save time. I'm Sherry Michael. I'm with Fish. I'm actually the rent coordinator. And just a brief overview. I'm going to scooch over out of that bright light there. That Fish is actually coming up on its 52nd year. and has evolved tremendously. I think many people have been involved in many different ways with FISH, also known as Friends in Sonoma Helping. FISH has a variety of programs that we provide, rent assistance, clothing, food assistance. We do home-delivered food to people who are homebound and are unable to get out. We have rides. We take people to medical appointments. I'm probably missing some things, lots of different things. But the thing that you may be the most interested in is our medical equipment program, and I'm going to give it over to Ann.
Hi, I'm Ann Shapiro. Sadly, our pamphlet does not include the fact that we give out donated, used medical equipment. All you need is a phone call, and we have a shed full of things. We don't always have everything you need at that moment, but we'll try and find it for you, and it's always free. You can keep them as long as you want. They no longer belong to us. They belong to whoever we give them to, and so sadly, they didn't put that in my pamphlet here, so I'm going to have to talk to somebody about that. But it just takes a phone call to the dispatcher, and they send me an email, and I will bring it to you if you can't meet me over at FISH. So we make it real easy, and it's free, and everybody's welcome. So we have wheelchairs, rollator walkers. We have shower benches and various other things that it depends on what they bring me, but mostly just large equipment. We don't do any kind of treatment medication, treatment things, needles, or tubing, and anything like that. But I'll be glad to help you out. All it takes is a phone call to FISH.
Just one real quick thing to that, as long as we've talked about Medicare a lot, most of what Ann does are the things that are not covered by Medicare. The shower benches, the walkers, which you've probably already run into, so it's a wonderful resource. Thank you, and thank you for inviting us.
Thank you very much. Wonderful organization. Okay. You want to give it another 5 minutes, or you think you're done? I'll skip you. Okay. Care Partners, we have Jim Keck.
You've heard a lot of this before. Pardon the repetition, but for those of you who have not seen our trifold, there's some in the back there. It covers our three main support programs that we offer. The first thing is our caregiver support group that we offer once a month. If anyone has not signed up for it and would like to, please do so at our table in the back. This gives us a chance to talk one-on-one with other caregivers, without our partners, our loved ones, and we have found it very useful. We are meeting here in the community room in the back once a month. Our next meeting is this next Thursday at 10:30 to 11. We find it very, very useful, and it is in person now. There are other support groups that Alzheimer's Association offers and so, but they tend to be in on Zoom, virtual, which we find less useful. The other program that we offer is our couples. Dorothy, my wife and I go with other couples for a brown bag lunch in a picnic setting with entertainment. Always very enjoyable. Again, if you sign up for the caregiver group, we would include you in emails inviting you to the social activities. And that's also a very good thing. The third program that is mentioned here is not really our own program. It's the Council on Aging. They're not here to speak about it, so I will talk a little bit about it. My wife goes every Tuesday and Thursday, 10 to 2, at the Vintage House, currently at the Vintage House now. Dorothy really loves it. It's a very well managed program. They have a lot of fun, lunch included. But the problem right now is that it's in a very small room. There's only room for 8 people, and an awful lot more need to be have advantage to attend a program like that. So what we have been working on recently, and we hope in the next month or so it will come to fruition, we want to meet in this room with allow 15 people to attend. That would be managed by Council on Aging still, with their 2 paid professionals and 2 of our volunteers, and it would allow a lot more people to attend. We want to go beyond that, though. We want to go have something similar up in Oakmont and down in Temelec. So that would be all of a sudden 45 people instead of 8. So that would be a big help. Besides our weekly and monthly gatherings, CarePartner offers education opportunities to help us understand dementia. And there's an awful lot to learn and an awful lot that we as humans don't even know yet, but we're working at it. So we offer quarterly forums like this, and we plan to offer small workshops and training programs in the future. We also have a collection of books that we have put in the Vintage House Library. We brought some of them here for you to look at and learn to appreciate what is out there. And we also have a monthly newsletter that you will find very useful. Please put your name and your email on the evaluation forms that Tom just suggested that you start filling out, and then you will get our newsletter, which will be very beneficial. I'd like to say a little bit about our website. You have the address there in some of the handouts. There's a lot of news and information there. We also have posted videos, recordings of our last 2 forums, and the video recording of this forum will be posted as soon as we have a chance to edit it and make it available. The other thing I would like to mention is how Care Partners has established an excellent relationship with local organizations. Just to name a few, Council on Aging, and are working with them to expand the day program. We also work closely with a chapter of Alzheimer's local chapter of Alzheimer's Association, and we share the information about their support groups. I've got a brochure here that I'll put out on the website also, and I'll maybe share with you on email. The local group here in Sonoma, I've been attending for a couple of years now, and I find it very useful. So besides our own caregiver support group, there are others that you might want to take advantage of. But besides Alzheimer's and Council on Aging, we work with the Village of Sonoma Valley. It's kind of new to a lot of you, but this flyer in your handout talks about what they do. We specialize in dementia, but they might help people in need with food and transportation and finding caregivers and so forth. So there's a lot of connection with local organizations. And then we also work with the Interfaith Ministerial Association to reach local church members and find out who in their congregations might need help, the help that we offer. So that's about it for now. I think gathering like this is going to be very helpful for all of us. But one of the problems that we're dealing with Alzheimer's, with dementia, is the fact that there is a stigma, and a lot of people don't want to be known as having the problem, and caregivers are facing that problem. So help us find people who need help and let them know what we offer, and I thank you very much for coming today.
Thank you, Jim. Okay, we got time for questions and answers now. If we, anybody, the speakers here, or anybody in the, our partner organizations, so just raise your hand. We'll bring the microphone to you so we can hear what you want. So, any questions? We didn't do that good of a job. Come on. It's a lot to think about today, and it's a lot to learn. Yes, hold on.
I have a question about the Durbo Power of Attorney for Healthcare, and it's online. You know, you can get the forms online. Does it need to be taken to an attorney, and does it need to have, a notary?
Those are really good questions, and I'm going to start by answering it because I have all these professional rules I operate under as an attorney, which is I can't create an attorney-client relationship in a question-answer setting. So I can answer this and attempt to answer it to the best of my ability in a general way. And that is that with respect to, you asked about the healthcare or the finance? For healthcare, yes, there are forms. I gave you two sample ones in this that are the simplified statutory version, as well as a longer, more extensive one by the hospice nurse that I mentioned. My recommendation is to take it to an attorney, but I am an attorney saying that, so that whatever document is being signed matches the goals that are at issue, and you also won't come up against a capacity hurdle. So when someone comes to me, when any client or potential person comes, I'm evaluating their capacity from the beginning. Sorry, it's true. But do people download these online and have them executed? Yes, absolutely. There are specific execution requirements. Notarization is very important. But again, if you really want to have something more solid, then it is worthy of the investment to have private counsel.
So one thing to add to that. California, is California more specific or less specific than other states? More specific, with certain verbiage, certain regulations, certain important details that if they are not there under California law and statute, you find yourself in a situation. So in taking something from the internet that may be general or may be written in a different state, do you really want to risk that when everything is on the line and that document needs to be put into effect? And I think, you know, that's where it's important to use that as a resource to kind of familiarize yourself. But the value of really sitting down with a professional can't be understated, because that's such an important decision.
I wish I would have known that Mary was evaluating us.
Mary, cognitive impairment is a gradient. It's a process, not a binary condition. One can anticipate worsening and get power of attorney for an aging parent, and some days they're compos mentis, and sometimes they're not compos mentis. At what point are they no longer responsible for themselves and cannot sign for themselves, for instance, hospital admission documents and hospital, et cetera? At what point does power attorney stand up, you know, for perpetuity stand? It seems like there's a gray area or an ambiguity.
Uh, I'm so sorry for what you're facing, and again, with the caveat, this isn't personal advice, it's general. There is a lot of ambiguity, and I can relay experientially that there have been clients that I've known for a long time that need to make changes, and all of a sudden it's advanced dementia, and they have intrusive thoughts, and they can't follow, and I will visit them numerous times in different settings. I'll go to the hospital. I do deathbed signings. Yes, I do. I will go where they are. I'll go into the nursing homes. I'll go to their homes. And if there is, if I can find that marble of consistency or that moment of clarity, and with the politics of a family behind them usually, right, and loved ones, then if that moment is there, depending on the situation, then things can be done. But yes, there can be a point at which, you know, the elder is not, or, you know, the loved one is not acting for themselves. I find that the folks who help in the medical field are very compassionate and helpful in this regard. I could really go on and on and on about this. So, Frank, do you have anything to add? No? Okay.
Any other questions? Here we go.
My husband and I have a will that states that when we both die, our children will get what we have left. And but it's very specific. It lists their name and their address. They no longer live at that address. Is that a problem?
Did I just hear a different state? So I'm happy to be a resource and do individual consults. I can't opine as to that with that type of vacuum. Wills are super specific. If people have assets over certain thresholds, depending what they are, the states go to probate, which is expensive. I'll send my kids to college on probates. People don't have to do that. So legacy planning and that type of thing, maybe Care Partners, maybe want to do a whole thing on that. But if you want to stay after and talk about it, I'm more than happy to talk with you.
Okay, any other questions? All right, well, thank you all for coming. I'd like Whitney to do the last goodbye.
A quick last word. Understanding, having a community that understands dementia and is a dementia-friendly community is one of our goals. And if you think about all of us understanding how to react to a situation like the story I'm about to tell you, that's what the goal would be. And it's a story that was in one of the books that's in the library. And a story about a grandson trying to communicate with his grandfather. His grandfather's got dementia, and the boy is trying to understand the situation. And he says to his grandfather, "Granddad, if you forget my name, don't worry about it, because I will enjoy telling you about me again, because I'm a pretty cool guy." You know, that's how we all want to embrace the families. And that's 10% of us that are 65, and if you're in your 80s, it's 1 in 3. So there are a lot of us out there, and let's have a dementia-friendly Sonoma Valley. Thank you for coming.
Thank you again, and please take some snacks or sodas with you on your way. Please, if you got questions, come and answer. And if you ever want anything else, call us on our number. Thank you.